So I guess we should start. Welcome everyone to this 11th episode of our webinar series, Artificial Intelligence and Religion, co-organized by the Center for Religious Studies and the Center for Information and Communication Technology of Fondazione Bruno Kessler in Trento. As always, please let me remind you, you will have seen the little message that this webinar will be recorded. So if you do not wish to be recorded, switch off your cams and mute your mics. At any rate, please leave your webcams and microphones switched off during the presentation. During the discussion later on, I will pass the floor to you, and so you can switch on your cams and mics on that occasion. Great. Today's speaker, Dominik Balazka. Dominik is currently has recently become, we have to say, a PhD student in sociology and methodology of social research at the universities of Milan and Turin. And before that, he has been, until very recently, a researcher at Fondazione Bruno Kessler with a double affiliation to our center, the Center for Religious Studies and the Center for Information and Communication Technologies. His research focuses on, research from a quantitative perspective. It currently focuses on religious nuns, non-affiliated, non-religious persons, survey methods, and the potential role that big data-driven research might play in research of non-religion. His talk today, which is, today he's going to present a joint work with Dario Rodighiero, titled "Was Blumer Right? Religious Values and Quantified Self in the Petabyte Age." So the reference is to Herbert Blumer, the American sociologist, and in the title, and to Blumer's rather skeptical views about the explanatory value of reference to values in the explanation of human behavior. So we're looking forward to your talk, Dominik. As always, 25 minutes, more or less, and then we'll have time for discussion. The floor is yours, Dominik.
Yeah, thank you very much. Just give me a moment to share the slides. Okay, so you should see it actually right now.
Yes.
Just let me know if there are issues, because I can see you right now. So first of all, good afternoon, everybody, and thank you very much for being here. To talk about artificial intelligence, religion in an empirically grounded way, it's not an easy task. Nonetheless, it is a reflection worth carrying on. Today, I'll focus on the value alignment problem, not in an attempt to solve the puzzle, but rather trying to point out useful questions to tackle in future years. Before starting, I want to say that me and Dario Rodighiero wrote and submitted the abstract of the work that I will present today more than 1 year ago. While our general position is mostly still the same as the one expressed there, in the meanwhile, it evolved slightly. So this afternoon, I'll try to present the results of these recent developments. A few notes about the structure of my talk. First, I will briefly introduce some key concepts. I'll then move forward, offering an overview of the debate about values in social sciences with particular attention to sociology and psychology. Far from being an exhaustive representation of the topic within the field, this is meant to be a selection of elements that can in our opinion, teach us something more about value alignment. Successively, I will move to Stuart Russell's formulation of the value alignment problem in an attempt to show how the debate that occurred within social sciences can help us to frame the ongoing debate on AI and religion. I will highlight some issues with the notion of value alignment, and to conclude, I will try to tentatively outline some possible directions in which the AI industry and social sciences might head together in order to build a coordinated approach. So, first of all, I would like to introduce some key concepts. The first is Herbert Blumer's critique of attitudes in empirical research, as Boris already anticipated. The second is Stuart Russell's idea of the value alignment problem. I will return to both of these points later on. For now, I only want to briefly introduce them. What Blumer says is that the belief that attitudes explain human behavior and the belief that the concept is suitable for science are both false. While some authors use the concepts of values and attitudes in a nearly interchangeable way, the two are not synonyms. Values are said to be more abstract than attitudes, and they are hierarchically organized in terms of their relevance for self, transcending specific objects and situations. Even though values are not attitudes, this latter category is typically used as a value expressive function and is frequently assumed to mediate the influence of values on behaviors. Now, let's move to Stuart Russell and his colleagues. A few years ago, Russell wrote that one threat has emerged that provides a potentially plausible source of problems. Potentially plausible. That is the inadvertent misalignment of objectives between machines and people. Of course, he is not talking about the perils for humanity of an artificially created superintelligence. He is a pragmatic man, after all, and the AI industry itself is a very pragmatic field, as you all know. In 2018, Alexa, a smart speaker device that you probably all heard about, suggested to a user to kill his foster parents. This is one of recent examples of the misalignment that we are talking about here. The problem here is not whether Alexa actually understands what those words mean and imply, nor how to teach to Alexa to understand their meaning. The problem is how to avoid unforeseen and unwanted responses. Now, I anticipated that we'll have a lot of questions today. I think that the first one is, why values matter so much? Why are we so interested in studying them? I think that one of the reasons why this is the case is because we are deeply convinced that values influence the way in which we act. And I think that, at least as far as social sciences go, we can trace this idea back to Max Weber. Weber developed a theory of action where subjective values held by the acting subjects are clad of motivational power. In Weber, traditions, motions, values, and goal-oriented reasons all constitute ideal typical motives of action. Once considered within the general framework of his theory of action, I think that the Weberian work on the Protestant ethic and the spirit of capitalism may be interpreted as an attempt to empirically investigate the material effects of a system of beliefs. In the theories inspired by Weber, values not only guide the actions selecting acceptable ends to pursue, but also selecting the acceptable means to reach them in a logically rather than teleologically coherent way. In other words, values have material effects, and that's why we need to study them. Now, at the beginning of the 20th century, Ralph Perry welcomed what he called the empirical turn in the theory of value. The issue in these years became widely methodological. How can values be investigated? Empirical research, however, soon ran into a problem. While the motivational role of values continued to exercise a fundamental role in the theoretical debate within the domain of sociology of religion, during the 1930s, several authors started to doubt its empirical validity in both psychology and sociology. The empirical enthusiasm, in fact, soon ran into two kinds of problems. The first issue was concerned with the empirical translation of the concept into a series of measurable items. The second issue was more problematic from my point of view. Once rudimental methods to measure values were established, the discovered link between values and behaviors was much weaker than expected. Or the method was wrong, or partially wrong, or the theory had to be heavily revised. Empirical tests struggled to find at least weak correlations and often ended up with finding no relation at all during the early years. But if values are such a powerful source of motivation for human agency, as Weber taught, then why empirical research cannot establish a clear link between professed values and actual behaviors? Dealing with this question, Herbert Blumer claimed that values and attitudes are empirically ambiguous and based on a fallacious picture of human behavior. Blumer's argument went further, and the author concluded not only that the concept is not suited to analyze and explain human conduct, but also that it is not scientific, and this has to be totally rejected from the corpus of scientific knowledge. Despite Blumer's firm refusal, in the 70s, the debate was still lively. Schumann tried to explain the incoherence emerged from empirical research within a Weberian framework, claiming first that the preference of conflicting values impacted the results, reducing the level of coherence, and second, that situational forces mitigate the influence of values in certain situations. Similarly, Kalman attributed discrepancies to an inner conflict and to situational constraints. However, at this point of the academic discussion, attempts to revive the concept had to deal with nearly five decades of ambiguous, conflicting, and somewhat inconsistent findings. To conclude this brief overview of the notion of values in social sciences, I would like to focus on three slightly disconnected aspects of the debate that might actually prove to be quite useful to tackle Russell and the value alignment problem later on. The first is Anne Swidler's idea of culture in action. Swidler, like Blumer before her, criticized the idea of value-oriented actions. According to Swidler, culture impacts human behavior by shaping a repertoire or toolkit of habits, skills, and styles from which people construct strategies of action. The shift from values to practices supposedly allows to study both stability and social change, and it is said by Swidler to produce an observable cultural object, to provide a link between culture and action, and to ease the issue of coherence. The second point is Shalom Schwartz's idea of societal values. According to Schwartz, it is possible to identify, and I quote, a universal psychological structure of human values, and to apply the structure to study cross-cultural differences at the societal level. Schwartz's transcontextual and transpersonal conception of values was well received in quantitative sociology, as testified by it, and by the integration of Schwartz's value scale in the World Value Survey and European Social Survey. Nonetheless, it brings challenges of its own. While interesting and certainly very useful, Schwartz's argumentative line have at least three problems. First, as DiMaggio wrote, his approach produces an overestimation of the consistency of intergroup differences. Second, Schwartz measure values globally and do not take the role of the context into account. Third, and probably most important, while Schwartz and other authors provide evidence for significant between-country differences, his societal values are aggregates of individual values, and as such, remain prisoners of Swidler's critique of normative theories. The third contribution that I would like to examine with you comes prevalently from cognitive psychology, and I think that this is the most interesting part. The assumption that values influence human behavior is widespread within the domain of cognitive sciences, but can all values exercise as motivational power equally, or specific values are more central than others. How and why a given value is activated. The starting point here is that values are just one of the many influencing factors that affect the course of action. So experimental studies proved that only a small portion of relatively central values inherently associated with the notion of self or identity have the capacity to effectively influence human behavior. Since central values need to be cognitively activated, and since situational forces and characteristics of the local network play a fundamental role in value definition and activation, not all values can be pursued at once. Mayo and Olson advanced in a series of studies and tested the hypothesis that values are accepted by individuals as truisms lacking proper cognitive support. The series of experiments showed that requiring subjects to motivate reasons behind values caused values to change. One of the most interesting implications of these experiments is that even central values may represent a largely unarticulated set of beliefs, make discrepancies between values and behaviors normal and even expected. While in time-constrained situations, people typically fail to accept ideas that they consider true, the lack of cognitive support in value-challenging situation allows situational forces to overwhelm values quite easily. These implications are confirmed by experiments which show that by providing subjects with reasons to support their values, value-consistent behaviors actually increased, and subjects perceived their values as rational rather than ideological. This has led to a relaxed formulation of the notion of coherence and to a radical change of perspective. The point is no longer whether values actually influence action, nor why values fail to guide human behavior most of the time, but rather why and at which conditions values are effectively employed in the decisional process. Now, let me stop here with this overview of measurement of values in social sciences, and let's have a closer look at the other concept, the value alignment problem. In his work, Stuart Russell identified three core principles of artificial intelligence. I would like to focus on the last one, actually. The machine, Russell says, must be able to learn about human values by observing the choices that we humans make. I think that this is a very relevant point because it tells us something important about Russell's idea of value alignment. As I see it, the problem is not that much how to measure values and align the machine with those values in order to reduce the existing gap. Rather, the problem is how to mimic socially and culturally acceptable patterns of practices. You remember Alexa? When the device suggested the user to kill his foster parents, it recognized a stimulus generated by the user, it processed it, and through a mathematical process identified on Reddit a suitable answer. Then Alexa simply quoted it. The problem is that the answer was just not a good one. So now I would like to move on by pointing out some problems of the value alignment problem as formulated by Stuart Russell. First of all, social sciences teach us that values vary considerably both between individuals and in their aggregated forms between countries as well, although the individual level variance is much larger than the one we observe at the country level. In talking about human values or values of the human race, Russell proposes an extremely broad and vague understanding of the concept that tells us very little empirically speaking. Clearly, I'm not here to solve the problem, but just to point out that there is the need for more clarity about what is it that we are actually trying to align by looking at the choices that humans make. But then the question becomes, once we stop measuring attitudes and start to mirror practices, as Russell is suggesting, are we still even interested in values? I think that without realizing it, Russell actually followed Anne Swidler. and that he was never truly interested in the idea of values in action, but rather in enacted culture. In this sense, I think that the label value alignment problem is at best ambiguous and misleading, and that it should be adequately reformulated. As Mayo and Olson showed, values are truisms that need to be cognitively activated. Furthermore, only values that are central to the subject's definition of self typically influence the course of action. In sociology and in cognitive psychology, as I showed earlier, this resulted in a relaxed notion of coherence and in a shift of perspective. Once we introduce these elements in the debate, it becomes clear, in my opinion, that to align values by looking at behaviors is a perfect receipt to produce an overcoherent and unrealistic picture of values in action. Russell is aware of this issue, and he points it out quite clearly, actually. The risk of overcoherence is certainly a relevant point, and I have to admit that for quite some time, it was one of my main critiques, at least until I finally realized that the value alignment problem is not that much about values, but rather about practices. While the problem of coherence is mitigated by the shift of attention from values to practices, some central questions remain. Namely, what is left out? And more importantly, alignment to what? Like Schwartz, Russell speaks about higher order aggregates of individual level measures. Therefore, like Schwartz, he has to be more explicit about the rules of aggregation in order to explain to what is it that we are actually supposed to align artificial intelligence. This is a necessary step forward because the general catch-all notion of human race is just not convincing. Once this fundamental work is done, it will become possible to critically examine the empirical implications of the adopted choices by pointing out what is misrepresented, what is overrepresented, and what is totally missing. Now, I think that in the debate around the alignment problem, at least two narratives are frequently mixed together. Here, we would like to introduce two concepts in an attempt to reorder this discourse. The first idea is that of an empathetic alignment, meant as an effective and deep mutual understanding. In other words, in talking about empathetic alignment, we want Alexa not just to become better at mirroring and imitating humans, but to become increasingly more human-like. On the other side, what we call emulated alignment presume an adaptive automation based on isomorphic processes rather than truly sentient responses. As I already showed at the very beginning of my presentation, when Russell speaks about the value alignment problem, he has in mind the latter and not the former formulation of the question. These two forms of alignment differ in terms of their relationship with the reality and presume two completely different ethical approaches to the problem. I'm not going to say that empathetic alignment is moonshine, like Ernest Rutherford did with nuclear energy before being painfully refuted the day after, but I have to stress that right now, this problem is not grounded in our empirical reality. In the petabyte age, there is a growing need for AI ethics, but not just any ethics. And to push the debate forward, it is necessary to clearly separate these two things. The next step, that is the shift of my attention from AI to big data, might be a bit sudden. After all, why should we talk about big data in a series dedicated to AI, right? The reason is actually very simple, in my opinion. That is that I believe that part of the reason why AI emerged so rapidly so quickly from its last winter is the large-scale diffusion of big data. AI relies on the availability of massive and constantly growing amounts of data generated online. As recent research on face recognition shows, the characteristics of these data sets are not without consequences. For this reason, In talking about AI, we should never leave big data out of the picture. Unfortunately, there is not enough time for me to digress about the matter. This could be a topic for discussion later on, or alternatively, I can point you towards the review that me and Dario published in Frontiers in Big Data a few months ago, titled Big Data and the Little Big Bang, Epistemological Revolution. What I need to establish here instead, in order to go on, is that in dealing with big data, researchers frequently rely on a misleading understanding of big data as raw, omnicomprehensive, theory-free, and neutral. By pointing out sources of human intervention and conceptualizing data collecting algorithms as theory-laden and selective human artifacts, we argued that big data shapes, not solves, shapes the pre-existing challenges, solves some of them, and introduces new ones. Therefore, the idea of raw data, as Boker pointed out in the 80s, is an oxymoron. Far from being pre-social artifacts, big data results from human activity, not simply in the sense of user-generated data, but in the sense of the development of technologies and infrastructures that make the existence of big data sets possible. As such, big data can embed pre-existing knowledge and reproduce biases. The exactitude and accuracy of big data should therefore be an object of critical examination rather than an assumed a priori, as frequently happens. So where to go from here, right? So far, I mostly asked questions, highlighted problems. Now I would like to try and advance some very tentative answers. First, I think that in order to strip the value alignment problem from its conceptual ambiguity, we need to drop the term value from the equation. This will certainly not solve the problem itself, but a clearer, more articulated, and explicitly formulated theory of alignment will arguably help to address both the ethical discussion surrounding AI and the empirical effort pushing it forward. Second, social sciences and AI need to collaborate to achieve the common goal of ethical AI in order to establish, to borrow an expression recently used by the European Commission, an ecosystem of trust. But to do so, they first need to find a common language. We need to stay pragmatic and to focus on the real problems that the AI industry is currently facing, leaving science fiction and empathetic alignment out. Sentient AI, singularity, transhumanism are all very interesting topics for social researchers. I'm not saying to simply stop studying them, of course. Neither I'm suggesting that science fiction is stupid or anything similar. After all, a lot of technologies that are part of our everyday life were once just science fiction. And Stuart Russell himself expressed this thought in multiple occasions quite clearly. What I'm saying is that if we, as social scientists, want to participate in the building of the AI of tomorrow, then we need to join the discussion focusing on questions that are relevant for AI today. And empathetic alignment is just currently not one of them. Third, we are talking about pervasive technologies that can considerably affect our everyday life. The perils of AI and big data are real, but this doesn't mean that we have to discard them altogether, right? Nevertheless, we need to be aware and to problematize these technologies heading towards transparency, accountability, critical assessment of data. I think that if you look at the work of researchers like Tibnit Gebru, Joy Bonwini, or Dorothea Bauer, these are names that you probably already heard, you will realize that this is a major concern in AI ethics right now. Nevertheless, far from being a well-established fact, it is an uphill battle against consolidated power dynamics, algorithmic opacity, and money-oriented production processes. Finally, AI and algorithms are data hungry. The more you feed them with data, the better they become. Nevertheless, biases are embedded in data and risk to reproduce age-old inequalities in a digital form. So speaking about Alexa at the beginning, I said that the problem is how to avoid unforeseen and unwanted responses, right? I would like to add that a frequently forgotten component of this issue is how to actually improve training data. We therefore need not just bigger, but also better data. A lot of research showed biases based on gender or ethnicity in various fields where AI and algorithms are employed, from face recognition to job advertising. Nevertheless, very little was done about potential biases based on personal beliefs. Does it mean that religious and non-religious minorities are all adequately represented? That there is no bias, no risk of discrimination, no inequality? Well, the answer is not straightforward. Maybe yes, maybe no, most likely something in between. But this is precisely why questions like alignment to what and what is left out are so important, and why we have to go beyond Russell's catch-all idea of alignment to values of the human race. With this, I'm mostly done. I hope that so far my point was clear enough. To conclude my presentation, I would like to ask one more question. And it will finally be your turn after to do so. This is actually a quite famous passage written by Kate Crawford, highlighting that big data can reproduce existing inequalities and biases. I think that reading these words now, right after I pointed out that that there is a lack of attention to potential misrepresentation of religious and non-religious minorities, might be actually very interesting. I think that the critical assessment of the quality of data should be one of our priorities, especially when this data is used to train AI or in decision-making processes. It is then necessary to ask, following Crawford, which people are excluded, which places are less visible, and what happens when you actually live in the shadow of big data. So that was actually it. And here are the references if you are interested in digging deeper into it. My contacts, feel free to email me or contact me in case of further information. And now I will stop sharing and let's discuss.
Thank you very much, Dominik. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, great. Thank you very much for this very clear, very, very interesting talk. We now have time for discussion. Just let me know in the chat. That's actually better. Just drop a line in the chat. So because I do not see all participants on my screen. So if you just raise a hand, I might miss you. So if you have a question, please say so in the chat and I'll keep the list. There's already one. Okay, from Eliana Fattorini. Would you like to ask the question to Dominik directly or should I read it?
Yes, sure.
Oh, there you are. Okay, great.
Yes, I'm here. Thank you for your presentation. I have a general question for you. Talking about artificial intelligence, you mentioned these power dynamics. So I would like to ask you if you could kindly explain which kind of dynamics you are referring to in particular. Thank you.
Okay, yeah. Well, this is actually part of what me and Dario speak about in the article that I pointed out. So in case that might be a source for further reflection. I mean, I think the main, let's say, perturbating force of power dynamics in this field is the change in the nature, let's say, of data. Before the arrival of big data, data sets were mainly collected by universities and research institutions interested in specific issues. Well, at one point, data sets and the most important data sets started to become private. Think about Google, about Facebook, about Twitter, And this basically means that it becomes more difficult to gather data, to access to data. It becomes more difficult to actually have a direct access to the algorithms producing the knowledge. So we are not necessarily always able to open them and see why exactly we receive the kind of response we are receiving, in part because they are part of sort of business secrecy. So Google is not exactly happy to share their algorithms with others, right? And I think that the major source of the changing power dynamics, at least from my point of view, is precisely this change in nature of data sets. They're becoming part of a private universe and pushing, let's say, the scientific domain, at least for certain data sets and for certain issues, to a much more liminal position. I think that, again, if you think about AI, I think that right now Google and Microsoft are some of the very the most prominent institutions working on the topics, and it really becomes hard to compete with that kind of power.
Thank you very much, Dominik. We now have a question from Inken Paul. Floor is yours. Hello. Switch on your mic, please.
I started with the camera. Thank you, Boris. Hi, Boris. Hi, everybody. Thank you very much for the talk, Dominik. I couldn't agree more with your conclusion on Stuart Russell. When I tried to read him, I threw the book into a corner because him and many others, they have so wrong assumptions about religions. And because they see religion, Stuart Russell, but also others, they see religion as monolithic blocks, which are all about value. And I couldn't agree more. Religions are, of course, about practices. But I'm a little bit disappointed that you use 20 minutes of your time to make a point which would make any handbook article of any newer book of religious studies in a jiffy. That religion is not about values, but about practices. So perhaps this is a problem with interdisciplinary work, but please have a talk to religious studies people. They will tell you, particularly if they are female, that religions are about practices and not about values. That's one thing, but I love the conclusion. And the second question I have is rather practical. You mentioned three names, and I took a quick picture, sorry, of your list of literature, but I didn't catch the three names of the three authors who are discussing nowadays huge problems of AI, because you said we have to leave our transhumanism dream fantasies, whatever, and have to be more acquainted with what the people, the roboticists and the informatics and the AI developers, what they actually talk about. So could you please say the names again and tell us what are they talking about?
Yeah, I will write the names in the chat.
Well, thank you very much.
So you can actually have a look at these. Hope I will write them correctly, because I always struggle with one of them. Okay, so you can have a look in the chat. Well, as far as your first point goes, well, I understand. Understand what you claim. I think that it's, as you pointed out, a matter of like interdisciplinary aspects, right? And I think that what I was trying to do was not to just speak to religious studies scholars today. Dario Rodighiero, my co-author, is definitely not a religious studies scholar, so that's not exactly our point here. what we are trying to do is to underline how religious studies scholars can actually start to collaborate with people working on AI ethics and AI development. Because I think that if you arrive there and you start talking about transhumanism and singularity, I don't know exactly what they will think about. So, I mean, the primary goal in this sense was to try and look for potential points of contact. And as far as the second point goes, I think these are mostly authors active in the AI ethics field. Because clearly I don't think that a more technical aspect of AI is, let's say, belong to this kind of presentations, at least not on AI religion. And I think that, I mean, Kenneth Gebru and Joe Bolwini are quite famous for their work on uncovering biases in algorithms. They published, I think, a few years ago, a quite notorious paper titled Gender Shades, showing, well, they were working on face recognition at the time, and they showed basically that AI is great if you are a white male. Because as soon as they started to consider female persons and black community in general, they started to observe a quite significant drop in the precision of these instruments. And you can see this kind of issues in several other fields. I mean, for example, we know very well that if you are a woman and you are looking for the job, you are much less likely than a man with the exact same qualifications that you have to actually see the jobs with the better payoff. So these are kind of, let's say, in a certain sense, stereotypes that we already have, right? And that using big data, we end up just throwing them inside the model and we end up reproducing them. And what these people typically do is to find them and try to look for corrective algorithms in order to reduce the effect they have. I mean, once we start to use, and I mean, we are already doing it, once we start to use AI for decision making, once we start to do algorithmic decision making, we need to be sure that we are that the process is fair and that we are not leaving anyone out. I think that this is why I think that alignment to what and what's left out are the key questions, because this is what helps us to think about what is it that we are actually missing in the picture. And I think that the reason why I concluded on the note on religious and non-religious minorities is because, as far as I know, that kind of research just simply doesn't exist. I mean, the main focus is on gender and ethnicity. And religion, I mean, it might be a fruitful a fruitful way to continue future, I think.
Thank you very much, Dominik. We now have a question from Paolo Costa. And if I may, I would like to put myself on the list after that, but I'm ready to drop my question. Paolo, the floor is yours.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Boris. And thank you, Dominik, for the challenging talk. Well, since I'm not familiar with you, with the way you reconstructed the post-Weberian debate about the role of values in human life, but I'm very interested in the issue of the role of values in human life. Of course, I'm very concerned. I'd like to try a different road, as it were. Yeah, maybe a possible bridge could be Swidler, because I know very well her teacher, Bob Bellam. And so I would like to reformulate your point about the non-alignment of AI machines with regard to the question of values. Well, let's think about your example of a teenager that is has a conflict with their parents, yes, and then he asks this very intelligent machine, what am I to do with my parents? And the answer is, kill your parents if they are a hindrance, an obstacle to your self-realization. So I wouldn't describe my personal reaction to this answer as unseen or unwanted consequences, but I would describe it as disturbing, disturbing kind of answer. So why is it disturbing? And I think it's the same if you ask this question. I'm very hungry today. What am I to do? And your computer says, well, you are an omnivorous animal, so just eat another human being. Yeah, I would describe this as very perturbing, disturbing form of answer. So why is it disturbing? And I think it's clear even from your point of view, why is it disturbing? Because even if you understand human life in terms of practices and not in terms of attitudes, of course, you know, there are goods internal to practices, of course. And if you practice a family life, for example, of course, you practice, you're within a web of practices that are focused, or we could say that are hinged on love or care or whatever. So if something says something that goes completely against this good internal to the practice, of course you don't recognize the practice anymore. So this is a very disturbing effect. It's not a matter of non-alignment, of course, but you are unable to make sense of the practice, of course. So this is what I expect from a machine, of course, the capacity to understand this aspect of the human condition that is so crucial. So the fact that there are things that matters to us as human beings in a very special way is not just that such consequences are unseen or unwanted. They are disturbing in a very profound sense because we are unable to make sense of that. So the idea that if you're angry, you could eat me if you want, of course, it's not just something that is unforeseen. It's something that makes you in a very, very scary situation that you fail to recognize, of course, what's going on around you. So I would suggest this, so my question is, in a sense, is precisely this. Can you make sense of this situation simply in terms of non-alignment, or something more is going on there? Yeah, thank you.
So I was thinking that in pointing out that the alignment issue is not that much about values, but more about practices, I first of all wanted to highlight an inconsistency in the current formulation of the problem. In order to request a more clear and articulated formulation, because I think that if this will remain just, you know, a general kind of alignment to human values, to general human values, whatever that means, then it can help us very little in actually understanding alignment to what and what is left out. So I think that it's mostly something that we should work on. And I think that this is precisely one of the points where social sciences can be helpful, when ethics can be helpful in developing an articulated and testable theory, criticizable theory. It isn't just some kind of postulation. Like, yeah, actually, it's fun that you mentioned eating, because Russell himself actually make a fun example about this. And he say, if I have a cat and I love my cat, I simply don't want the cooking robot to decide that the proteins are good for me and to cook my cat, right? And that's the point for him. And I think that the question is, the problem is in a certain sense that AI, I mean, what it does, I mean, I was speaking about Alexa, right? The example that you mentioned as well. And what it actually does, I mean, what it does is that it's simply, it's playing a role. And the problem is that it typically doesn't, it really struggles with irony and other similar human approaches, you know. So well, there is a very interesting research, a qualitative research actually recently published in Big Data and Society, when they actually collected a series of tweets. Then they basically used an algorithm to perform a sentiment analysis, which is a type of analysis used to basically detect how people, let's say, feel about the thing that they speak about. And then they simply try to do it by hand and compare the results. And what they saw is precisely this, that the algorithm typically misunderstand the irony and it takes it seriously. So I don't have an answer, but again, I think that these are the aspects when people like you can actually have something to say, which is why I simply wanted here to point out possible points of contact, a fruitful contact, in order to start speaking the same language. Because clearly, if we have very different agendas about the same thing, then it's really difficult to cooperate, and it's really difficult to do something like what the European Commission was kind of postulating in defining a sort of common European approach to AI, right? But then we really need to find a common ground and start from there and restart.
Thank you very much, Dominik. I don't see any other question on the list, so I permit myself to ask a question myself. So I mean, I found several points that you made, taken individually, quite convincing. But I think there is a kind of tension here in what you said. In the following sense. So you first argued for the claim that at least Russell would be well advised to not talk about value alignment anymore, because what he should be after is a non-empathetic form of alignment based on the observation of human behavior. So basically, we want artificial agents to better simulate human behavior, observable things, observable in data sets, and so on and so on. So you argued for the claim that value alignment is not really about values. So to make a long story short, but then you finished by saying, look, but there are biases. Oh, there's this problem of biases now. And we should, of course, take care of that as well. Now, the tension is this one. Maybe it's even a very strong form of tension, maybe even a contradiction in what you've said, but maybe I got you wrong, is this. Those biases are precisely taken from the observed human behavior. So if you say that in the value alignment problem, we should strive for this kind of non-empathetic but more simulated or emulated form of alignment, which is based on the observation of human behavior, but then say, there are biases in human behavior, so we should somehow correct that. What you are appealing to, are values that lead you to saying that biases are bad, in some cases at least. What you're appealing to are values which are not manifest in the behavior that you say value alignment should strive to emulate. So in a sense, you do make in this broader idea about value alignment, which I kind of agree with, but I think there are tensions in what you said. You appeal to a notion of value, precisely bias against a gender-based bias, ethnicity-based bias, and so on, is something that we do not want to replicate in our AI systems. So you make appeal to a dimension of value which is not manifest in the data sets that AI systems learn from. So that's I'm not sure I explained myself.
But. Yeah, no, I got your point. So first, I'll try to answer, and hopefully I'll this might be the only answer they actually managed to provide today. First, when I say that Russell should look at practices and should look at, when you said that I said that he should do this, I'm not sure that you got me right there. What I'm saying is that that's what he is looking at, and that's what the AI industry is doing. I'm not saying that it's best strategy or whatever, but what they need clearly is an observable object, as you rightly pointed out. That was precisely one of the points of Ernst Widler. The fact that values are not observable while practices are. The point was, let's have a look at practices because that's easier. That's something that we can do. Well, values, well, more or less, right? And that was at least, let's say, the very. So it's not that they have to do it because that's the best strategy, but clearly that's how they do it. And we have to take that into account, that they are actually working on that. And clearly, precisely because that's the way they are doing it, they end up incorporating the biases. And clearly that's a problem. Maybe that's value. I'm not suggesting that we have to drop values from social sciences entirely. I mean, I don't agree that much with Blumer. That was more a kind of provocative question in the title. I think that you look at Schwarz, for example, if you look at the European Values Study, if you look at the World Values Survey, well, I think that we are doing some very great research with values. What I think, however, is that that's not what AI is doing. So in a certain sense, if we have to say them something about ethics, we have to at least adapt to what they are practically doing. So I think that they are working on practices. I think that this introduces some biases that needs to be account for, because clearly we don't want to discriminate people on the basis of gender, sexual orientation, or whatever else, right? And that's precisely where the point is, I think, that we have to work on this, that we have to conduct research on this. This clearly means that we have to deal with algorithmic capacity, that we need to open the black box and have the possibility to look in. And the first question that I actually received, the one about power dynamics, it kind of merges this thing in the sense that this is very difficult when the data and algorithms are private in nature. And I don't have a simple answer to this. I think that this is precisely the puzzle. And I think that this is one of the points where social sciences and ethics can actually contribute.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dominik. I see no other questions in the chat, so I think we can conclude today's meeting. Thank you very much again, Dominik, for your very interesting talk. And thank you to everyone who just joined and listened or participated in the discussion. Our next episode of our webinar will be on Wednesday, the 10th of March, the usual time, 4 p.m. to 5 p.m. CET, and our speaker will be Yorick Wilkes, a computer scientist and AI researcher from the University of Sheffield, with a talk entitled AI and Religion. So very on topic. Yes, thank you very much again, Dominik, and everyone for being here. And we hope to see you again soon, in 2 weeks' time. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.